Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Sword and the Drow by Martha Carr and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Devon Sorvari. Chapter 1. Cheyenne Summerlin rolled over in her bed and reached for the stack of pillows she'd grown used to grabbing in her sleep. Instead of pillows, her hand slapped down heavily on air and she almost rolled onto the floor. Her first instinct was to keep from falling. Her hand lashed out, and the force of her newly unlocked telekinesis threw her back onto the small bed while splintering the wooden floor beside her with a crunch. The halfling drew her hand back and pushed herself up to sit in the narrow twin bed, blinking herself awake. Where the hell am I? In 2 seconds, she recognized the massive bookshelf against the wall and the desk against the window. Cheyenne groaned and vigorously rubbed her cheeks. Still at Shea Summerlin, I did everything I could to stay out of here. The halfling blinked at the ceiling and tossed her childhood comforter off before slipping out of bed. When her gaze fell on the shallow crater she'd blasted into the floor, she winced. She stooped to drag the black area rug from in front of the bookshelf to the divot in the floor, covering it relatively well. Eleanor's gonna find this the next time she cleans in here. Right now, I'm pretty sure a dented floor is the last thing on Mom's mind. Cheyenne slipped into her clothes from yesterday, then grabbed her phone off the nightstand to check for messages. There was nothing. So Corian found nothing, or he's just too busy to bother. Fine. She shoved the phone into her back pocket and froze when the sounds of soft laughter and clinking glasses carried toward her from down the hall. Tilting her head, the halfling opened the door to her old bedroom and glanced at the breakfast room at the back of the second story. The doors were open, and she caught a brief glimpse of Eleanor walking across the room before the woman disappeared. They sound awfully happy, considering what's going on right outside. The halfling shuffled down the hall, running her fingers through her tangled black hair. A few strands caught on her septum piercing, and she grimaced as she fought to free her face from her hair. Then she reached the open doors to the breakfast room and raised her eyebrows. They'd rearranged the chairs to face the long, curved wall of windows so Ember could roll her wheelchair up to the very center. In the cream armchairs on either side of Cheyenne's fey friend sat Bianca Summerlin and Eleanor, both of them dressed and ready for the day. Eleanor had just sat back down in her chair, but turned with a grin when Cheyenne cleared her throat. Good morning, sleepyhead. Bianca shot the woman an amused glance before raising her Bloody Mary to her lips. We thought we'd let you sleep in this morning, Cheyenne. The halfling smirked. It's only 7:30. Correct. Bianca drank. I do hope that's not nearly as late as you normally sleep. Doesn't your earliest class start at 8:30? Cheyenne shot the back of her mom's head a playful frown. If it was anyone else, I'd wonder how she knew that. Not anymore. The halfling crossed the wide room toward the three women enjoying themselves and the now less than peaceful view of the valley behind Bianca Summerlin's home. I think I started to tell you last night. My schedule's changed a little. She stopped behind Ember and put a hand on her friend's shoulder. You doing okay in here with these two? The fae looked at her over her shoulder and smirked. I think I can hold my own. Eleanor chuckled. And she didn't even join us for a Bloody Mary. I had enough to drink last night, thanks. Bianca sat back in the cream armchair and lifted her chin. I admire a woman who knows when to say no, despite her saying no to me. Ember shot Eleanor a worried glance, and Bianca's housekeeper waved her off, whispering, She's joking. Mostly. You're fine. Cheyenne headed toward the breakfast cart Eleanor had rolled into the breakfast room every morning for as long as she could remember. The woman had laid out her usual spread, buttered toast with a variety of jams in tiny jars, hard-boiled eggs, an assortment of fruit, and a French press, now empty, next to a matching set for cream and sugar. The Bloody Mary tray, of course, sat on a side table beside the cart. The halfling reached for a slice of toast. I would very much like to hear about how your class schedule has changed, Cheyenne, Bianca muttered after another sip of her morning cocktail, seeing as that is news to me. Spreading strawberry jam on her toast, the halfling glanced quickly at her mom, who only stared through the curving wall of windows. My professors decided all our time was better spent if I taught undergraduate classes instead. Eleanor choked on her drink and pressed her napkin to her lips. Bianca shot her a quick glance, the corners of her mouth twitching into a tiny smile. Do you think it's time better spent? Cheyenne shrugged and took a huge, crunchy bite of toast. It alleviated a lot of scheduling issues. Bianca leaned forward in her chair and turned to look at her daughter for the first time this morning. The halfling hunched over, keeping the crumbs in her mouth, and pulled a napkin from the tray. She didn't speak again until she'd swallowed her food. Sorry. Her mom leaned back in her chair, satisfied with Cheyenne's return to proper etiquette. As long as it works for you, that's what matters. I always thought you should have been teaching those classes anyway, Eleanor added, twirling her straw in her Bloody Mary. I could teach my own graduate classes. Cheyenne caught Ember's amused glance and forced herself to look out the window to keep from laughing. Right now, I'm teaching stuff I learned halfway through high school, but it'll get me my degree, so I was fine with making the change. Not happy with it? Bianca took another sip of her drink. Not quite, but it's better than nothing. At least I get to choose what I teach. That was part of the deal, a fairly loose lesson plan. I'm glad it's working for you. Nodding, Bianca returned the majority of her attention to the view. Cheyenne didn't miss the slight flare of her mom's nostrils as the woman's gaze once again fell to the huge scar of jagged black stone jutting toward the house from the tree line. The halfling looked across the acres of well-manicured lawn Bianca called her backyard and studied the Fro agents who'd camped out there overnight. She is not happy about that, but her irritation is way better than leaving her exposed to whatever else might come out of that new portal. She couldn't help but try to make light of it. How's the morning entertainment? Bianca rolled her eyes. Not entertaining in the slightest, Cheyenne. You know how I feel about this entire arrangement. I do. The halfling took another bite of toast. I also am perfectly aware of the necessity. Bianca tilted her head and rested it gently against the back of the armchair. That doesn't mean I have to like it. The morning doesn't quite start off the same way with such a different view, Eleanor added. She glanced at Cheyenne and raised her eyebrows. That's code for Mom woke up on the wrong side of the bed. Can't blame her. The halfling scanned the breakfast cart for coffee cups, and Eleanor seemed to read her mind in an instant. Oh, Cheyenne, let me pull another cup out of the cabinet for you. I can get it. No, no. It's not every day we get to see your smiling face first thing in the morning. When the housekeeper saw Cheyenne's deadpan expression, she snorted. See? Lovely. And I might as well make myself useful when our routine's been interrupted as it has been. Pull up a chair, sweetheart. I'll get you some coffee. It's dangerous for me to argue with you this morning, isn't it? Bianca choked back a small laugh as Eleanor pushed out of the armchair. Your mother seems to think that's funny, but I'll tell you right now that you're absolutely right. We all have a job to do. Eleanor turned toward the back of the breakfast room and shrieked. Eleanor! Bianca nearly spilled her cocktail in surprise. What in the world? The housekeeper stared with wide eyes at the dark circle of light appearing mid-air just inside the double doors. Cheyenne whirled to see the conjured portal opening even wider, then Corian stepped through into Bianca Summerlin's house. The halfling's mother leaped to her feet, her tall Bloody Mary glass clenched tightly in one hand, which she extended out to the side as if to keep the suddenly appearing night stalker away from her drink. What is that? Shit. Cheyenne leaped forward, giving Eleanor's shoulders a brief, gentle squeeze as she passed the woman. I got it, Mom. It's fine. Wait. Corian stared with glowing silver eyes at Bianca Summerlin, the tufted points of his ears twitching in confusion. Out! Cheyenne pointed into the second floor hallway as she stormed toward him. The Night Stalker blinked rapidly and shook his head before finding the presence of mind to cast an illusion spell. The feline features of his face flashed briefly before shifting into those of a human man with blonde hair and a slight flush creeping up the sides of his neck. Cheyenne, Bianca warned, not moving as she stared at Corian, the cat man who'd just appeared out of thin air in her breakfast room. I'll take care of it. Be right back. The halfling shoved Corian backward out of the room, spinning him before pushing him farther into the hall. He kept trying to steal glances over his shoulder at her mom, who glared at him, one eye twitching until Cheyenne pulled the French doors closed behind her. What were you thinking? You can't just open a portal wherever you want, especially not in this house. The Night Stalker snorted and shook his head, unable to wipe the surprised smile off his human-looking lips. Good to see you too, kid. I got your text. Chapter 2. That was seriously delayed. Cheyenne folded her arms and raised an eyebrow. I texted you almost 12 hours ago. What can I say? I was busy following that name. Did it lead to a person? Oh yeah, and then some. The fiery light of triumph glinted behind the Night Stalker's eyes, even through his illusion. And I stopped by your apartment. You did it, Cheyenne. The halfling's eyes widened when Corian withdrew her drow legacy box from behind his back. The runes glowed with a soft golden light all over the copper surface, every layer locked into place and now forming a much larger pattern of runes she still didn't understand. I did it, she muttered, staring at the lockbox. My guess is your run-in last night with those things from the in-between did the rest of the work for you. Cheyenne's fingers tingled with warm energy when she took the Kuil Ani from her mentor's hands. So all it took was for me to almost die fighting off those things on my own. Good to know. Corian snorted. Open it. Are you crazy? The halfling shot a quick, cautious glance over her shoulder at the closed French doors and lowered her voice. I can't open this here. One border portal and a team of Fro agents in her backyard is about all the magic my mom can handle. You pushed her tolerance over the edge when you popped in unannounced like that. I didn't know she was here. I was looking for you. Obviously. She brushed her fingers over the locked layers of the puzzle box and nodded. I need to go clear up that mess first. What mess? Hey, when Bianca Summerlin stands from her chair and shouts in surprise at the first Night Stalker she's ever seen, there's a mess. Cheyenne tapped her temple. It's all up here, but that makes it even more important to deal with it as soon as possible. And then I have to take Ember home and make sure she's good before I start running around opening drow legacy boxes. That's your friend? When the halfling nodded, Corian's human-looking nose twitched in a very cat-like way. Smells like Fae in that room. Well, there's nothing wrong with your sense of smell. She glanced at the closed doors again. You really need to go. I'll call you when I'm back at my apartment. He flashed her an oddly feral grin for his human illusion and nodded. You'd better. And hurry, kid. The real work begins now, and L'zar will want to know as soon as possible. Yeah, he visited me last night in my head. Cheyenne's lips twitched into a smirk. He's not very happy with you for going off on your own little mission, by the way. Apparently, you're supposed to be my babysitter. Very funny. The Night Stalker's fingers worked in a quick series of precise patterns, and the dark circle of a new portal opened in front of him. Call me as soon as you can. Yep. Corian glanced at the Kuil Ani in Cheyenne's hands one more time, then stepped through the portal back to wherever he'd come from. After the circle of dark light disappeared with a soft pop, Cheyenne darted into her childhood bedroom and tossed the activated lockbox on her unmade bed. Last thing Mom needs to see is the one thing L'zar left her that night besides me. She quickly returned to the breakfast room, knocked lightly on the doors, and turned both handles to push them swiftly open again. All taken care of. Sorry about that. Bianca and Eleanor had both sat down again in the cream armchairs. Bianca's long, calm inhale sounded particularly loud in the silent breakfast room. I accept your apology, Cheyenne, and I expect that little mishap to be the first and last of its kind. It will be, Mom, I promise. It shouldn't have happened in the first place. I should think not. Cheyenne pressed her lips together and met Ember's gaze when the Fae girl looked over her shoulder. I left Ember right in the thick of Mom's rage. Time to get out of here. You ready to head out? Ember gave her a thin smile and rolled her wheelchair back before turning around smoothly. Ready when you are. Yeah, I think it's time. I'm gonna go check in with those agents outside, then we'll head home. Sounds good. Ember glanced at Bianca, who stared straight ahead through the curving wall of windows. Thank you for inviting me up here, Bianca, and for your hospitality. The woman of the house didn't move an inch. Ember glanced at Eleanor, who gave her a sympathetic smile. When the Fae looked at Cheyenne, the halfling nodded toward the open doors. The second Ember started to wheel forward again in her chair, Bianca's hand shot out and settled lightly and briefly on the Fae girl's forearm. Ember stopped to look at Cheyenne's mom with wide eyes. You are always welcome here, Ember. That's not an invitation I hand out lightly. Thank you. Bianca extended her hand, which Ember took after a second's hesitation. It was a pleasure to meet you. You too. Thanks again. As soon as Bianca released her hand, Ember wheeled forward again. Eleanor stood from her chair. I'll see you out. They got to the open doors together before Bianca called after them without moving from her chair. Eleanor, please bring up some tea. A strong Earl Grey, if you don't mind. Of course. The housekeeper turned and dipped her head, even though Bianca couldn't see it. Then she ushered Cheyenne and Ember out into the hall and closed the French doors softly behind her. Not one of our better mornings. Cheyenne raised her eyebrows. I noticed. Mind if I take the wheel, Em? Take all of them. The girls shared amused glances. Then Cheyenne grabbed the wheelchair's handlebars. She sucked in a sharp breath and glanced at the puncture wounds in her palms. I need to start keeping that dark tongue salve on me all the time. Gritting her teeth against the sting, she pushed Ember toward her room. I'll meet you down there, Eleanor said as she headed down the wide, sweeping staircase to the main floor. Thanks, Eleanor. The woman waved her off with a noncommittal hum, then Cheyenne stopped outside her room and darted inside to grab the legacy box. She took a quick look at the unmade bed, tucked the box under her arm, and made the bed in less than 30 seconds with a quick shake of the comforter and a re-propping of pillows. When she returned to the open hallway of the second floor, Ember shot her a small, knowing smile. What? Cheyenne shrugged. It was bred into me, all right. I didn't say anything. You didn't have to. The halfling grabbed the box from under her arm and dropped it in her friend's lap. Will you hold on to that for me? I need my hands. Ember stared at the Kuil Ani as Cheyenne wheeled her toward the Shea Summerlin elevator. This looks different. That's because it is.
Did you?
Yep. Apparently this halfling's all grown up and ready to claim her legacy, whatever that means. Cheyenne pushed the single call button on the wall beside the elevator. As soon as we're home, I'm heading off with Corian to open this thing and figure out what the heck that legacy is. The door opened slowly, and the halfling wheeled her friend inside before punching the button to take them down. You should open it now. I really shouldn't. Cheyenne snorted. Whatever's in there was meant just for me. Obviously, there's already been enough craziness in this house for one visit, and if that box starts up its weird light show and who knows what else, I don't want you, Eleanor, or my mom anywhere near it. Ember removed her hands from the box and raised them in front of her chest. Relax, I'm pretty sure it won't do anything until I open it. Yeah, that's reassuring. The elevator shuddered a little when it reached the ground floor, then Cheyenne pulled Ember out and into the industrial-sized kitchen. Eleanor stood at the stove over a boiling kettle of water and gave the girls a brief, distracted smile over her shoulder. "I'll be right there, just making the tea." "No problem. We're not out of here just yet." Cheyenne took them along the side of the kitchen and out the swinging doors into the open hall that ran down the side of the house. "Okay, you got it from here? Still working on super tight spaces?" Ember grabbed the wheels of her chair and nodded. "There aren't a lot of those here." "Good. I'll be right back." Heading toward the front door, Cheyenne turned back and pointed at her friend's lap. "Don't lose that box. Kind of important." Ember's eyes widened, and she stared at the Drow legacy box in her lap as the halfling slipped out and closed the door swiftly behind her. Cheyenne stopped for a moment to take a deep breath of the fresh morning air, then shook her head. It's too early for a heaping helping of fro attitude. She jogged down the wide, curved stone steps at the entrance to the house, then headed around the garden and down the other set of stairs toward the backyard. When she stalked out from beneath the jutting balcony of the veranda, she could feel her mom's gaze shifting to fall on her. Cheyenne didn't turn around or look up. Give her enough time and she'll get over it, as long as these guys do their job and keep her safe. Reinhardt and his team were up and ready for duty, though some of them still sat in the grass, nursing their tin cups of instant coffee. The portable camping stove, or whatever they'd used, had been put away already. Wouldn't put it past one of these guys to light up a ball of fire in their hand and use that instead. "How's it going out here?" Reinhardt turned from glaring at the currently inactive portal ridge to glaring at her. "Good morning to you, too." "It's not, really. I just want to make sure it's not about to get any worse." He gestured toward the black columns of jagged, glistening black stone that cut a straight line from the little fro camp to the forest. "Kind of impossible, don't you think? As long as you and your guys keep back whatever else might come through this thing so it doesn't get to the house or my mom, I'll count that as not getting worse." "Well, you can make your report then, halfling." Reinhardt raised an eyebrow. "This thing's been as silent as the grave since we got here." Cheyenne looked up at the top of the stone pillars. "No flashing lights?" "Nope." "Okay. That doesn't mean it won't still happen." "Kid, I know what a portal is. At least the kind I'm used to regulating on the reservations. What I don't know is how the hell this thing got here." The halfling shook her head. "I really wish I had an answer for you." Reinhardt turned again to study her longer than 2 seconds. His scowl remained, but his irritated glare had softened into understanding. "We'll hold out here until we get the order to pack up and ship out. I have a feeling that won't be for a while."
"Yeah. Me too."
Cheyenne studied the portal ridge one more time, then met the man's gaze and nodded.
"Thanks for being here."
"It's my job, otherwise I wouldn't be."
"Right, I know."
She nodded at the agents scattered behind their team leader. Some of them looked up to meet her gaze with a brief nod. Most of them minded their own damn business.
"Call me if anything changes. And I know you have my personal number, so don't bother asking about that dinosaur phone you guys gave me."
Reinhardt smirked.
"If anything happens up here, you'll be the first to know. After I make the calls I gotta make to keep my job, orders and all that."
"Sure."
The halfling turned to head across the lawn, paused, and glanced at him one more time.
"Good luck."
"Yep."
Reinhardt shifted his folded arms and sniffed, gazing at the portal ridge. With a quick nod, Cheyenne stalked back toward the house. Her gaze flickered briefly to the wide wall of windows on the second floor that curved in the same line as the extended veranda below. The morning sun glinted off the windows, so she couldn't see anything in the breakfast room. But she's watching. That's what she does. Watches and waits. Only this time, she won't be able to do anything if something happens. That's a first. The halfling hurried under the veranda and around the side of the house to jog back up the steps. If I play this right,
Mom won't have to lift a finger.
Chapter 3.
All right, let's get out of here. Cheyenne left the front door open a crack. Ember shrugged. I'm just waiting for my chauffeur. Very funny. Eleanor hurried back down the staircase, her face flushed. I wasn't about to let you two slip away without saying goodbye. Cheyenne stepped willingly into the woman's open arms, anticipating the crushing hug Eleanor never failed to give. The housekeeper's arms closed gently around the halfling instead, as she murmured into Cheyenne's ear, "She loves you and only wants what's best for you." "I know." The halfling hugged Eleanor back and smiled when the woman pulled away and held her at arm's length. "It's been very good to see you so much lately. This should happen more." Eleanor's smile disappeared, and she blinked quickly before letting out a tiny, choked-off laugh. "Not exactly like this, of course. I'm not sure how much more she can take before I'm cleaning up shattered glass off the floor of every room. You've got plastic tumblers still, right?" The housekeeper chuckled. "Yes, Bianca Summerlin drinking cocktails from a plastic tumbler. When that happens, be ready for the world to end." For some reason, the words made Cheyenne's insides squirm. She covered it with a tight smile. "The world's not ending. Not this one. Thanks for everything, Eleanor. As always. I wouldn't have it any other way." The woman patted Cheyenne's cheek, then turned toward Ember with an even warmer smile. "It was so nice to finally meet you, Ember. I know it's already been said, but I'm allowed to make my own invitations. Anytime you want to come back, you just make Cheyenne drive you right up here. Got it?" Ember laughed and accepted Eleanor's hug as the housekeeper bent over to wrap her arms around the fey girl. "Thank you. I had a great time." Eleanor raised an eyebrow as she straightened and patted her gray hair back into place. "Yeah, even with everything that happened," Ember added, "it's good to get out. I've been saying that to the woman up there for 20 years. Maybe she'll listen if she hears it from someone else." The housekeeper winked, then turned to head back up the stairs. "You drive safely, do you hear me? None of that reckless fast car nonsense." Cheyenne walked backward toward the door, spreading her arms. "Can't make any promises." "Oh, get out of here." Chuckling, Eleanor went up the steps. The halfling held the door open for her friend, and Ember wheeled herself to the threshold before pausing. "You want me to help?"
"Nope."
Ember tightened her grip on the wheels.
"Let me try."
"Sure." The wheelchair rolled back an inch, then Ember lurched forward and pushed herself out onto the landing. The wheels caught for a split second on the metal liner of the doorway, and she tipped forward before a pale violet light flashed around the wheels of her chair. She hovered 2 inches off the ground and slowly lowered to the stone landing, her knuckles white around the rims. "You still got it." Cheyenne stepped outside and shut the door behind her. "I don't think it's going anywhere."
"Just had to check." Ember grinned. "This is wild."
"I have a feeling it's gonna get wilder." The halfling stopped at the edge of the first step, folded her arms, and considered the wide, curving stairs in front of them. "What about now?"
"Yeah, definitely."
Ember nodded quickly and pulled the drow lockbox farther into her lap. "I'm not going to try to conquer a whole staircase." Chuckling, Cheyenne grabbed the chair's handlebars and spun her friend around before tilting her back onto 2 wheels. "It's more like half a staircase, but I get what you mean." They moved down the steps as gently as possible. When the halfling's black vans crunched on the gravel, she kept pulling back to get Ember to the passenger side of her brand new Porsche. "Easier to go down than up, isn't it?"
"Was that supposed to have some kind of double meaning?"
"I'm talking about stairs, Em." Smirking, Cheyenne opened the passenger side door and helped her friend transfer into the seat with a practiced ease they'd nailed down over the last few days. Then she folded the chair and took it to the trunk before sliding into the driver's seat. The engine started with a push of the button. "So that was my mom and my home life, packed neatly into 15 hours.
I like her."
Ember shrugged. Even with the giant rock sticking up out of the ground and you fighting off monster things. Well, that part was new. Still, your mom's incredible. I don't know anyone else who'd just stand there and watch all that while sipping a drink. Cheyenne laughed and buckled her seatbelt. She tried to hide it, but I saw her sneak a few swigs here and there. Can't blame her for knocking back booze like she was. The halfling shifted into drive and took off slowly around the huge gravel circle in front of the house. Nope, can't blame her for that. For other things, but who's keeping score? She drove down the long gravel drive and the gentle incline down the hillside away from Bianca Summerlin's estate. After everything that had happened in the last 15 hours, silence was definitely golden. Neither of them said a word until Cheyenne turned onto the frontage road that would lead them out of Henry County, Virginia, and back toward Richmond. So, Ember cleared her throat and stared at the puzzle box in her lap. That guy back there who showed up out of nowhere. Never seen a Night Stalker before, huh? The Fae's eyes widened. That was Corian? That was Corian. The halfling let out a long, slow breath. His timing's bad about 50% of the time. He's basically saving my ass the other half. And he brought you this box? Yep. Said the breakfast room smelled like Fae, too. So now he knows who you are. Oh, jeez. Ember rolled her eyes. It's always the smell. Hey, for me, it was the ears. Cheyenne flicked her high-voltage raven black dyed hair and shook her head. Glad I don't have to worry about that anymore. Not when you're wearing that thing, huh? The Fae nodded at the Heart of Midnight pendant around Cheyenne's neck, the thin silver chain studded with retied knots. Oh, that. I was thinking more along the lines of having a lot more control over what I look like these days. But yeah, this thing's about worn out anyway. I've got plenty of chains if you need a new one. No, I meant the pendant. Apparently it has a shelf life, but I'm pretty sure. The buzzing phone in her back pocket cut her off, and she shifted to pull it out before glaring at the screen. Brace yourself. This might get weird. Who is it? Sir himself. Cheyenne rolled her eyes and accepted the call. Where the fuck is he, halfling? She pulled the phone, emitting the shouting voice, away from her ear and shot a quick glance at it. If you mean Reinhardt, he's still at my mom's, where you ordered him to be.
Reinhardt! I'm not talking about Reinhardt!
Sir barely turned away from his phone to let out a stream of profanities. Ember looked at Cheyenne with raised brows, and the halfling shrugged.
I got a call from Chateau Drawl this morning. L'zar Verdys pulled his second disappearing act in the last 22 years. Know anything about it?
Shit. She scowled at the road. No, I don't know anything about it. I'm not his keeper.
You're his goddamn daughter, Cheyenne. I want to know where that lunatic drow is. Besides the guards on Alpha Block with cat shit for brains, you're the last person who talked to him.
I have no idea where he is. Remember that giant opening that showed up out of nowhere at my mom's house? That's where my focus has been lately.
Well, refocus.
Sir let out a deep growl.
I want to see your number on my screen the first time you catch a reeking whiff of that son of a bitch. You hear me?
Kinda hard not to when you're shouting.
Figure it out.
There was a loud slam and a click, then the line went dead. Cheyenne pressed her lips together and tossed her phone into the cubby under the dashboard. Ember eyed her warily. I'd ask what that was about, but I heard the whole thing. Yeah, the dude's got serious anger issues. L'zar's out. Why? The Fae cocked her head in consideration. I mean, besides the obvious part about not wanting to spend any more time behind bars, but wasn't he supposed to be protecting you from something by staying in the prison? That's what I thought. Cheyenne swallowed, But I passed the drow trials. That means I'm not another dead drow kid he's trying to groom for his rebellion, so the prophecy's been blasted to smithereens. A dark gray blur, streaked with white, darted down the road toward them. It passed so close to the Panamera that it knocked the back end sideways. Shit! The car fishtailed on the narrow frontage road, and Cheyenne jerked her foot off the pedal, rocking the steering wheel back and forth to correct the swerve. She got the thing straightened out in seconds and glanced into the rearview mirror. What the hell's going on? Whoa! Ember pushed down on the seat with one hand and braced herself against the window with the other. You okay? The Fae had gone white, and she heaved a shaky breath. We almost went off the road, but we didn't. The streaking blur backtracked and whizzed past Cheyenne's window before stopping 2 yards in front of the car. The halfling slammed on the brakes in a spray of gravel and fine dust, rocking her and Ember forward against their seatbelts. The second she recognized L'zar Verdys standing in the middle of the road, his white hair strewn wildly around his grinning face, Cheyenne slammed her palm on the horn and counted to 5. He didn't flinch. She dropped her hand into her lap and shifted into park. What the fuck? Ember's mouth worked silently until she found her voice. Who's that? Our escaped convict. The Fae whipped her head toward Cheyenne and whispered, That's L'zar? The drow in question tossed his hair out of his eyes and stepped calmly toward the driver's side window. Cheyenne glared at him until he rapped gently on the glass with the back of his hand, then slowly rolled the window down. What are you doing? L'zar ducked his head to peer at his daughter and her friend in the passenger seat. Looking for you. That's fairly obvious. It took me forever to track you down, Cheyenne. Take off that damn pendant, will you? Can't argue with an order straight from the top, can I? Without breaking her father's gaze, the halfling jerked the chain around her neck, which broke as easily as ever, and tossed the whole thing into the cubby with her phone. Why were you tracking me? The drow sniffed the air delicately and peered around his daughter at Ember. Your car smells like Fae. L'zar? Oh, come on. Aren't you going to introduce us? No! You're standing outside my car in a prison uniform looking like a full-on drow for everyone to see. What are you doing? I came to help you, which you're going to need more than ever from here on out. His gaze fell on the copper, rune-studded legacy box in Ember's lap, and those glowing golden eyes widened. You did it. Yeah, I did it. Trials completed and passed with flying colors, just like saving my own life. You can't be here. L'zar blinked, his grin widening, and slowly lifted his gaze from the box to his daughter's face. I'm pretty sure I've just proven I can be wherever I want, Cheyenne. Are you trying to get locked up again? No, don't answer that. I got off the phone with the froze head honcho 2 minutes ago. They're pissed that you're out again. Naturally. And they think I know where you are. What did you tell them? Cheyenne gave an exasperated grimace. The truth, which was different 2 minutes ago. I'm sure they have a whole team of freshly geared operatives just itching to find you. So far, you're making it really easy. That's fine. L'zar glanced at the legacy box one more time, and his grin widened. We'll just go back to your place. No! That's the first place they'll look for you. It's not a secret anymore that I'm your daughter. Have you opened it yet? Seriously, enough with the box! His long, slender, slate-gray fingers clamped down on the open window as he leaned closer. Have you? Not yet. I'm smart enough to save that for somewhere private and safe, which apparently you've forgotten all about. I want to be there when you do. Cheyenne shrugged. Fine. I'm calling Corian when I get home, and we'll deal with it then. You should go find him and get out of the open before you bring down a whole bunch of shit I don't need on both our heads. L'zar didn't move, so the halfling slipped her finger under the automatic window button and rolled it up. The corner of the drow's grinning mouth twitched as he stared at Cheyenne with wide eyes. A tiny bit of pressure from his hands stopped the window with a mechanical whine. Cheyenne jerked her hand off the button and gritted her teeth. The next second, her pale skin and dyed black hair were replaced by the purple-gray flesh and bone-white locks she shared with her drow father, and a burst of violet sparks erupted from her fingers and crackled across L'zar's hands. He withdrew them slowly from the window, chuckling as he took a step back from the car. "Go find Corian," Cheyenne said as she rolled up the window. "He's probably at the warehouse. I'll find you when I'm ready." The window slid into place, and the drow convict smiled.
"I can't wait."
Shaking her head, Cheyenne shifted into drive with a quick jerk and took off down the frontage road toward Richmond.
"Holy shit!"
Ember swallowed and glanced at the legacy box in her lap.
"And I thought I had dad issues."
"It's all relative, right?" Ember barked a laugh as Cheyenne reached for her phone and pulled up Corian's number. He answered on the second ring.
"That was fast.
I'm not back yet. Just called to give you a heads up. I'm not the drow who needs a babysitter. You've got an old friend heading to the warehouse right now, FYI.
"He's out?"
"No, Corian. Chateau Drawl's taking him on a field trip on account of his good behavior." The Night Stalker growled into his phone.
"What an idiot."
Took the words right out of my mouth. Corian's sharp laughter made her pull her phone away.
"He just couldn't wait any longer, could he? Damn. Don't forget to call me when you're ready to join the party, kid."
"That would be impossible. I'll be home in less than an hour."
"Good."
Another laugh burst through the line, then Corian hung up on her without another word. Cheyenne tossed her phone back into the cubby and shook her head.
"Here we go."
Chapter 4.
Cheyenne opened the front door to the loft apartment she and Ember shared and stepped inside to hold it while Ember wheeled herself through.
"Sorry, I have to bail right back out of here."
"You're not bailing." Ember picked up the legacy box and held it out toward the halfling with a smirk.
"It's your destiny or whatever."
"Huh."
Cheyenne took the box and turned it over, studying the bigger symbols created from all the tiny runes now locked into their correct positions.
"It better have more for me than a crazy-ass drow and a bunch of pissed-off fro on my heels."
"Fingers crossed."
The girls shared a wry laugh, and Cheyenne set the box down on the armrest of the couch before heading into her room. She pulled off her shirt and took a quick whiff. "A shower. Tonight. That's final." Her pants dropped on the floor, then she headed toward the glistening black drawer with the silver skulls for knobs on the drawers and rifled through her clothes. She picked a maroon shirt with black fishnet from chest to collar and black skinny jeans. Cheyenne tugged it all on, then shrugged and crossed the room. The brown glass jar of Yaji's healing salve was right where she'd left it in her backpack on the floor, and she twisted off the lid before taking a tentative sniff.
"Smells awful. Hurts even worse."
She dipped a finger into the pale, taffy-like salve, twirled it around to get rid of the stringiness, then set the jar down on her black velvet comforter. Grimacing, the halfling smeared a bit of dark tongue goo on the palm of one hand and grunted. The grunt turned into a growl as the salve did its work, burning through her hand and bringing tears to her eyes as it sealed the fresh wound from the inside out.
"You okay?"
"Just healing myself,"
the halfling shouted into the living room.
"No big deal."
Ember's wheelchair rolled with a soft rumble across the floor, and she stopped outside Cheyenne's bedroom.
"Healing yourself?"
The halfling nodded toward the jar on the bed.
"Free salve from a friend. Apparently, people pay with their own organs or something just to get this much."
She lifted her goo-tipped finger with a shrug, wiped it off on her other hand, and smeared the rest of it over the hole in her other palm.
"Oh, damn it."
The fae chuckled.
"No pain, no gain, right?"
Cheyenne whirled around to shoot her friend an exasperated glance. The last time someone told me that, I was barely conscious and strapped to a hospital bed that wasn't anywhere near a hospital with handcuffs that turned off my magic.
Ember wrinkled her nose. Trigger identified.
With a snort, the halfling looked down at her puncture-free hands, then grabbed the jar and screwed the lid back on tight. A blast from the past. Trust me, you could call me every derogatory term in the book, and it wouldn't sound as stupid as when Sir says, "Good work, halfling." The accuracy of her impersonation made her laugh. Then she shrugged back into her black jacket, grabbed her backpack, shoved the salve back into the bottom, and nodded at the living room. With a raised eyebrow, Ember wheeled backward out of the doorway, and Cheyenne closed the door behind her.
Time to open that box, I guess.
Let me know how that goes.
The halfling looked over her shoulder at her friend as she headed for the puzzle box on the couch.
Don't I always?
Doesn't mean I'm any less curious about whatever special prize is in there. The Kuil Ani joined the dark tongue salve at the bottom of her pack.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.